The Tower of Power, too sweet to be sour, funky like a monkey, ooh yeah.
Macho Man Randy Savage.
It's hard to pop him, he gets the party jumping, he's a Macho Man.
Macho Man Randy Savage is, without a doubt, one of professional wrestling's greatest icons. His career spanned from 1973 until 2004, but over the next 2 weeks, I'm going to be talking about his career from 1985 through 2000, the portion of his career the majority of wrestling fans know him for. This week is all about the portion of his career that the fans look back on with the most fondness, his World Wrestling Federation career from June 1985 through November 1994, roughly 2 weeks after losing a Loser Leaves Town match in Memphis to Jerry Lawler, Randy Savage made his debut with the World Wrestling Federation and instantly started his first storyline with the company. After defeating Aldo Moreno in less than 3 minutes, out came every heel manager in the company: Bobby Heenan, Freddie Blassie, Jimmy Hart, Mr. Fuji, and Johnny Valiant. Randy was the, quote, top free agent in professional wrestling. Every manager wanted Randy Savage, and this gave Randy instant recognition to those who never saw him prior. All these managers wanted this one talent. He must be something special. This went on for roughly 2 months before Randy made his decision. He gave all five managers their due. However, in the end, he picked someone who wasn't one of the five bidding for him. His choice was a woman we never saw before, didn't know anything about. That woman was Randy's then legit wife Elizabeth, later known to the world as Miss Elizabeth. Elizabeth would play a huge role in the bulk of Randy's WWF career. Early on, she was there to get heat on Randy. In kayfabe, he would treat Elizabeth like she was lower than him. In result, the fans hated Randy Savage. It was a unique pairing. Elizabeth was more or less a babyface manager managing a heel wrestler in the Macho Man. It worked, and it resulted in one of the greatest on-screen pairings in the history of pro wrestling. Randy would defeat a lot of enhancement guys early on in his WWF career, but soon after, he was after Federation Gold. In fact, he was after all the singles Federation Gold, because he would do house show loops against Tito Santana over the Intercontinental Championship, he would do house show loops against Hulk Hogan over the WWF Championship. You could tell the company had big plans for Randy Savage early on. This went on both sets of feuds through the summer and fall of 1985. Randy's pay-per-view debut was, the very first WWF pay-per-view ever, the Wrestling Classic in November 1985. There, he was a part of an elimination tournament where he defeated Ivan Putski, Ricky Steamboat, and the Dynamite Kid on his way to the finals, losing to the Junkyard Dog by countout in said finals. Randy would finish 1985 and enter 1986, still on the house shows facing Tito and Hulk for the IC and World titles respectively. Finally, on February 8th, 1986, Randy Savage won his first piece of World Wrestling Federation gold, defeating Tito Santana in controversial fashion to win the Intercontinental Championship, setting off on one of the greatest reigns with that belt in the history of the belt. Savage's reign with the Intercontinental Championship began with rematches against Tito all throughout the house shows and challenging Hulk Hogan for the world title. But Savage's major rival throughout his early run as Intercontinental Champion was against George the Animal Steele. While the match quality was not the best here, the storytelling was really good. Steele had just turned babyface, started developing a crush on Miss Elizabeth. He saw Liz with Randy, who had the IC title, and did the math. If he won the IC title, he would get Elizabeth. Savage and Steele would start a near one-year rivalry at WrestleMania 2, with Randy getting the win, retaining the belt. Savage and Steele would continue their matches on the house shows throughout the summer and into the fall. Savage would also continue working Tito in rematches, Hogan in world title matches, worked JYD over the IC title, worked Pedro Morales, a former Intercontinental Champion, even worked Jake in some heel-heel matches over the belt. But it was all during this when Randy started one of his most memorable programs, his program with Ricky the Dragon Steamboat. It started off as a series of house show matches, but an angle on television began the road to WrestleMania 3. During a televised match in November 1986, Savage targeted Steamboat's throat, once on the guardrail, the other with a ring bell. This would write Steamboat off of television for months after this. In the interim, Savage needed to feud with people on screen. Sure, he had various matches versus various opponents on the house shows. Savage would have two on-screen major rivals while Steamboat was kayfabe on the shelf. The first one was with living legend Bruno Sammartino. By this point, Bruno was semi-retired, he was a commentator, but the two had a fight after Savage injured Steamboat, setting up a series of matches between Savage and Bruno. The second one was the reignited feud with George the Animal Steele, who by this point had become friends with Steamboat. Savage and Steele had many marquee Intercontinental title matches in early 1987, one of which was a winner-take-all match. Winner not only got the Intercontinental Championship, but also got the managerial services of Miss Elizabeth. Savage would win all these matches, but this was just interim stuff to eventually set up the return of Ricky Steamboat. I should point out that during the time Steamboat was written off of television, he and Savage would still be wrestling all across the house shows. Some say that those matches were just as good as the match I'm about to talk about next. WrestleMania 3, Randy Savage, Ricky Steamboat for the Intercontinental Championship. A match that we still talk about 3.5 decades later. Reason being, well, one of the greatest matches in WrestleMania history. And the reason for that is because Randy was very particular on how his matches went. He wanted perfection. So he laid out this match move by move. He and Steamboat would memorize it. It was somewhere near 200 steps, 20 false finishes. It created magic. Ricky Steamboat would defeat Randy Savage to win the Intercontinental Championship, ending Savage's 414-day run with the belt, still to this day the third longest reign with the belt in its history, a legendary match that, while Steamboat won, it set Savage up for something bigger in the future. Randy's post-Intercontinental Championship reign post-WrestleMania 3 was huge, and it was the start of a big change for the character. Of course, he had his rematches against Ricky Steamboat for the IC title, he challenged Hogan for the world title, but then he started working a few heel-heel matches against Butch Reed, which wasn't out of the ordinary because he did those against Jake Roberts the year prior. But then he started working heel-heel matches with King Harley Race. Then the One Man Gang. Then the new Intercontinental Champion, the Honky Tonk Man. Throughout the summer, into the fall, it was Randy Savage versus the world. He would ping-pong from opponent to opponent. One night he's facing Hogan for the world title, then he's facing Harley Race, then the Gang, then Honky Tonk Man for the IC title. All the while, he's slowly turning babyface. Then in September, he defeated three heels in the King of the Ring tournament, King Kong Bundy in the finals, on his way to the 1987 crown, though he wasn't officially Macho King just yet. Now, the reason for this sudden change in fan reaction from boos to cheers was due to the new Intercontinental Champion Honky Tonk Man. He defeated Ricky Steamboat in a huge upset on television, and Savage was there to congratulate him. But then Honky Tonk decided to talk shit about Randy Savage, saying how he defeated Steamboat when Savage couldn't, that made him better than him. Honky Tonk Man's the greatest Intercontinental Champion of all time. Every champion before him, Savage included, needed to recognize that. Savage made it his goal to recapture the belt. The feud with the Honky Tonk Man was Savage's official babyface turn. They had their house show run, a very successful run, by the way. Their first major televised match was on Saturday night's main event in the fall of 87. Savage wins by disqualification, Hart Foundation interfere, Honky Tonk Man shoves Elizabeth to the ground, takes the guitar to Savage, Liz goes backstage, comes back out with Hulk Hogan. Hogan and Savage cleaned house, had a moment of surveying the situation, then the two shook hands. This was the start of Hulkamania and Macho Madness coming as one, the start of the Mega Powers. Savage and Honky Tonk would continue their run through the end of 1987 into the start of 1988. Savage's team defeated Honky Tonk's team at the Survivor Series, bunch of DQ and countout finishes at house shows. And the initial plans in this feud was to culminate it with Randy Savage regaining the Intercontinental Championship at the main event in February. But due to a huge dispute in creative post-main event, Honky Tonk Man kept the Intercontinental Championship. But as a consolation prize, Randy ended up with something much bigger. After the World Wrestling Federation Championship became vacant after the main event, a tournament was to be held at WrestleMania 4 for the vacant belt. Savage was a part of the tournament and was considered one of the favorites to win the whole thing. Savage defeated Butch Reed in the first round, Greg Valentine in the second round, and One Man Gang in the semifinals, leading to a huge finals between he and Ted DiBiase to determine the new undisputed WWF champion. After constant interference from Andre the Giant, Savage sent Elizabeth backstage, and she came back out with Hulk Hogan. Since the heels cheated first, Hogan and Savage cheated in return, Hogan with a chair to DiBiase, Savage with the elbow drop, 1-2-3, Randy Savage is the undisputed World Wrestling Federation champion. Post-match, you had the iconic shot of Savage holding Liz on his shoulder with the belt, Hogan and Savage with another handshake, and with Hogan leaving for a while, Savage was now the man, winning 4 matches in one night to become the world champion. Post-WrestleMania 4, Randy Savage began his reign as World Wrestling Federation champion against Ted DiBiase and Andre the Giant in programs all across the house shows. Between April and October of 1988, it's a line of Savage DiBiase and Savage Andre matches for the WWF Championship. But for the first SummerSlam in August 88, we got one of the company's most star-studded matches of all time. Hogan had returned, he and Savage would team as the Mega Powers. In the main event of SummerSlam 88, they would face the team of Ted DiBiase and Andre the Giant, known as the Mega Bucks. The two top faces versus the two top heels. Each side had the top face and heel manager respectively, and Jesse Ventura as the wild card special referee. While the Mega Bucks thought that they had the advantage, the Mega Powers had the secret weapon. Near the end of Mega Powers Mega Bucks, we saw the secret weapon when Elizabeth took off her skirt, distracted DiBiase, Andre, and Ventura, while Hogan and Savage recovered. The Mega Powers won at SummerSlam 88, but post-match began the road to WrestleMania 5. While yes, you had the celebration of the Mega Powers during the post-match of SummerSlam 88, during that post-match, Hogan began being closer to Elizabeth than Randy, and stuff would continue at Survivor Series 88. Once again, the Mega Powers won their big main event match. Hogan celebrated with Elizabeth. You could see Randy was starting to get frustrated with Hulk. During all of this time, Savage was still the man, the WWF champion, defending against all comers, from Andre the Giant, to Dino Bravo, to Bad News Brown, to Akeem, to the Big Boss Man, and Savage retained against all of them. Royal Rumble 1989 is when things almost exploded between Savage and Hogan. During the Rumble match itself, Hogan accidentally eliminated Savage, which made Savage pissed off. The two nearly came to blows until Elizabeth came out. The two cooled off. They made up. However, at the main event 2 in February, that is where things between Savage and Hogan could not be repaired. The Mega Powers were facing Big Boss Man and Akeem, known as the Twin Towers. Savage got thrown to the outside, accidentally landed on Elizabeth. Hogan went to check on Liz, carried her to the back, abandoning Savage, making that 2-on-1 for the short period of time. Hogan would then come back out, once again a tag match, went for the tag, Savage slapped Hogan and left. While they did win the match, it didn't matter at all. Savage accused Hogan of lusting over Liz, didn't want to be a man, and asked Savage for a title shot, among other stuff. Savage beat Hogan up afterwards. This was the end of the Mega Powers, though, should point out, while on screen Savage was a heel, he was still working babyface against Bad News Brown in WWF title matches all across the house shows. And that leads us to WrestleMania 5. The Mega Powers explode. Savage, Hogan, WWF Championship, a match so huge it set records that remained for a decade. Elizabeth would remain in a neutral corner for this one, as she couldn't choose one over the other. A classic WrestleMania main event, ending with Hogan getting the 3 and winning back the WWF Championship. Savage's 371 days as WWF Champion is still tied for the 8th longest reign in the history of the belt. After WrestleMania 5, Randy Savage was a full-fledged heel once again, and Elizabeth was no longer his manager. In April, Savage got a new manager, Sensational Sherry. I feel like the Savage-Sherry pairing doesn't get enough credit, because at this point in time, the pairing between him and Sherry was a perfect fit. Savage and Hogan had many rematches on the house show for the world title. Also on house shows, Savage started working with Hogan's best friend, Brutus Beefcake. In the build-up to SummerSlam 89, Savage got a new tag team partner in Zeus. Zeus had come in to get revenge on Hogan for what happened in No Holds Barred the movie. The trio of Savage, Zeus, and Sherry created very memorable segments in the lead up to SummerSlam, and at SummerSlam, you got a big tag team main event, Hogan and Beefcake versus Savage and Zeus. Elizabeth would come back and be in the corner of Hogan and Beefcake, and Hogan and Beefcake got the win here. Now, while Savage didn't recapture the world title from Hogan, Savage would capture a title of a different kind when in September of 1989, Savage officially became Macho King when he defeated King Jim Duggan for the crown. You had a huge coronation with Savage and Sherry that was done by Randy's brother Lanny Poffo, known as the Genius. Savage was now Macho King, Sherry was now Queen Sherry. Savage would end his 1989 with title matches against Hogan, a series of matches with Duggan, a Survivor Series win, and a huge steel cage tag team match teaming with Zeus against Hulk Hogan and Brutus Beefcake at the No Holds Barred movie match pay-per-view. For the bulk of 1990, Randy Savage feuded with Dusty Rhodes, a feud that on paper should be a big deal, in execution, not so much. The thing with this feud was royalty versus common. Savage was the king, Dusty was the common man. This also involved the two wrestlers' managers, Queen Sherry and Sapphire, respectively. You had interactions at the Royal Rumble. At WrestleMania 6, you had a big mixed tag match, Savage and Sherry versus Dusty and Sapphire. Dusty and Sapphire won, Elizabeth returned here, was in their corner. Besides a few matches with Roddy Piper, Dusty was Savage's main opponent on house shows through the spring into the summer of 1990. At SummerSlam, they had a match, or more or less a segment, as this was used to further along a feud with Dusty and Ted DiBiase. Savage won at SummerSlam, and the feud between the two was over. Savage was back in the WWF title picture post-SummerSlam, starting a run of matches with then-champion Ultimate Warrior. Lots of countout finishes between the two on house shows through the end of 1990 and at the start of 1991. On television, Savage made his intentions known he was the next contender for the belt. After Royal Rumble 91, whether it be Warrior as champion or Slaughter as champion, he wanted the first crack at the belt. Slaughter agreed, Warrior did not. Hell, even after Queen Sherry seduced Warrior, Warrior still said no. That led to, at the Royal Rumble, Savage costing Warrior the WWF Championship against Slaughter, and in kayfabe, Warrior more or less cost Savage a shot at winning the Rumble match as Savage no-showed escaping from the Warrior. You had a series of cage matches after the Rumble. On television, it was made clear the WWF wasn't big enough for the both of them. A career match was made for WrestleMania 7 between Randy Savage and the Ultimate Warrior. As great as Savage Steamboat was at WrestleMania 3, this match here at WrestleMania 7, you could make a case to be in Randy Savage's magnum opus as a performer. He, like all his big matches, laid this one out move for move and got this legendary great match out of the Ultimate Warrior. Everything about this, from the beginning to the end, was perfection. Warrior got the win. Post-match, Queen Sherry attacked Savage. Elizabeth jumped the guardrail to make the save. Savage and Elizabeth had their emotional reunion, one of wrestling's all-time best moments, and this was initially supposed to be Savage's legit retirement, but, like the majority of all wrestling retirements, did not last long. Randy Savage's retirement lasted all of a couple of weeks, as he wrestled a few matches post-WrestleMania. To cover it up, though, they ran the contractual obligations angle. After those matches, Savage was retired. He was at the broadcast booth. He was a neutral character now, mostly babyface, but would still give crap to other faces every so often, mostly the Ultimate Warrior. Savage would return to an in-ring role on house shows during the summer to replace the Warrior. On screen, he was still retired. The stuff between him and Elizabeth was getting serious. So serious, he proposed to her. A wedding was set for SummerSlam 1991. Yes, they were legit married off screen, and coincidentally enough, this was around the time where their legit marriage was starting to fall apart, but they decided they were going to do an on-screen wedding for their fans that have been watching them for all these years. And at SummerSlam 1991, this was the closer. Yes, a wedding main evented a pay-per-view, Madison Square Garden, a great SummerSlam moment, the perfect wrestling wedding. However, the reception is where Randy Savage's road to reinstatement began. Jake Roberts had gifted a snake to Randy and Elizabeth. The snake came out during the opening of the gifts. Undertaker and Jake attacked Savage, they scared Liz, before being chased away by Sid Justice. Behind the scenes, Warrior had gotten suspended after SummerSlam, so they needed a new opponent for Jake. At house shows, the two began to have a string of matches against each other. Savage both competed as himself and as the character of Mr. Madness, who was definitely not Randy Savage. Because on television, Savage was trying to file for reinstatement. He had gotten denied. A campaign began to reinstate the Macho Man. During this was maybe the craziest moment of Savage's entire career, which is saying a lot, and that's when he got bit by a real cobra on television. After the cobra bite, Savage was reinstated. He couldn't compete at Survivor Series 91, but could compete at the next pay-per-view less than a week later, this Tuesday in Texas. Savage defeated Jake. Post-match, Jake slapped Elizabeth, igniting the feud even more. Now, logic says this is going to be the WrestleMania match, but the program on screen ended at Saturday night's main event in February. Savage and Jake did a series of cage matches on house shows to end their feud after main event. The reason for the sudden end in the Randy Savage-Jake Roberts program is because, well, something lying on Arsenio Hall. Randy Savage got slotted into the WWF title match at WrestleMania 8 against then-champion Ric Flair. The story here went that Elizabeth was Flair's before she was Randy's. It was the Macho Flair affair, as they called it. Another classic Savage Mania match, culminating in Randy Savage winning his second WWF championship. What a difference 12 months makes. He goes from legit retired to World Wrestling Federation champion in 1 year. After WrestleMania 8, Randy Savage began his second reign as WWF champion, having world title rematches against Ric Flair, a few world title defenses against the Mountie, and some great world title defenses against Shawn Michaels. The Ultimate Warrior was now back in the WWF after a suspension, and the two were seemingly peaceful to one another. But when Warrior was named number one contender to Savage's belt at SummerSlam, the feud between the two reignited, though nothing about WrestleMania 7 was used in the build for SummerSlam 92. Instead, the build here was all about Ric Flair and Mr. Perfect stirring the pot, trying to create drama between Savage and Warrior, saying Perfect would be in the corner of one of the two at SummerSlam, but at SummerSlam, Perfect would be in the corner of none of them, causing distractions for both. Warrior would win the match by countout, Savage retained the belt. Post-match, the two buried the hatchet, and this was the start of the short-lived team, the Ultimate Maniacs. You almost wish they would have done Savage Flair 2 at SummerSlam, because only a few nights later, they had Ric Flair defeat Randy Savage to win back the WWF Championship at a TV taping. Allegedly, their first match during the taping was so bad, Vince made them go out and do the match a second time. Newcomer Razor Ramon helped Flair win the belt from Savage. After losing the belt, Savage and Razor began a feud of Macho versus Machismo. You also got Savage Flair rematches throughout the fall of 92. Savage and newly turned Mr. Perfect formed the Perfect Team after Warrior was fired. The two defeated Flair and Razor by DQ at Survivor Series 92. Savage would end the year in matches against Ric Flair and Intercontinental Champion Shawn Michaels. 1993 began the decline of Randy Savage as an in-ring competitor in the WWF. Sure, he was the runner-up in the 1993 Royal Rumble match, and sure, he had some big matches here and there, but mostly around this time, Randy was starting to work with a lot of the lower card guys, if he was working against anybody at all. Hell, his major feud at the start of 1993 was he feuded with the Repo Man over Repo stealing his hat. At WrestleMania 9, Randy did not have a match. Instead, he was in the broadcast booth with Jim Ross and Bobby Heenan. After that, he started having matches against Doink the Clown and Giant Gonzalez. At the next pay-per-view King of the Ring, Savage once again did not have a match. Once again, he was in the broadcast booth. When he wasn't doing matches or doing commentary on WWF television or house shows, he was doing matches in the USWA during the WWF USWA program. He would get a few house show WWF title matches against Yokozuna in the summer of 93. But for SummerSlam, Savage did not have a match. Hell, he wasn't even in the broadcast booth. Instead, Savage was used to introduce Lex Luger for his match with Yokozuna for the WWF title. Why all of a sudden has Randy Savage gone from WWF champion in 1992 to being used sparingly in 1993? Well, Vince gave Randy the old, "We're going in a youth movement" excuse. He felt Randy was more valuable as a commentator than as an in-ring performer in a high-profile role. At the time when Vince needed stars, Hogan just left. Randy was the only star he had in terms of being a true star. Randy was the perfect guy to bridge the gap between the old era and the new generation. But no matter how useful Savage could have been in the ring, Vince kept him in the booth. That was until the later portion of 1993 into the early parts of 1994, as Randy Savage would take place in his final in-ring program in the WWF, and that program would be with his legit friend Crush. Crush had returned from being bonsaied multiple times by Yokozuna, felt Randy wasn't being a good enough friend during his absence. They had their summit on Raw to air out everything. Seemingly everything was patched between Savage and Crush. Until Crush attacked Savage. They were blurring the lines with this feud, having Savage mention how, once before a friend stabbed him in the back, he didn't want this to be like that, all in reference to he and Hogan's real-life heat at this time. 1 week on television, Savage attacked Crush, which commentators were not allowed to do, resulting in a temporary leave from the broadcast booth for the Macho Man. During Survivor Series 1993, the two distracted each other during their respective matches, leading to each other's eliminations. Savage in the opening match, Crush during the main event. They had their interaction at the Royal Rumble in 94. Crush cost Savage winning the WWF title from Yokozuna in February. All of this culminating at WrestleMania 10. In the build-up to WrestleMania, Savage might have cut the best promo of his entire career. That's saying a lot because Savage has a lot of all-time great promos. It's 5 minutes of him talking about how WrestleMania 10 was going to be him getting his dignity back. Check it out. It's as real a promo as you will get at that point in time. Savage would defeat Crush at WrestleMania 10. Unfortunately, WrestleMania 10 would be Randy Savage's last televised match in the WWF. He would wrestle here and there on house shows after WrestleMania 10, crushing some rematches, Diesel, Jerry Lawler, a WWF title match against Bret Hart, but on television, Savage was back in the commentary booth. Two famous nights for Savage, one for good, one for bad. The bad, King of the Ring 1994 with Art Donovan. The good, him and Jim Ross calling Bret Hart 1-2-3 Kid on Raw in a classic WWF title match. But Randy still wanted to wrestle. He even pitched an idea to work a program against Shawn Michaels, but Vince said youth movement and kept Randy behind the booth. He cuts a dynamite promo in the build of WrestleMania 10, but it doesn't matter. Vince sees Randy as a commentator. Randy's final pay-per-view appearance was at SummerSlam 1994. He didn't even call the show that night. He was the host of SummerSlam, and he only made a few appearances during that night. Randy's final matches in the WWF took place in September, a string of house show tag team matches, teaming with Bret, defeating Owen and Anvil. His final WWF appearance was on the Halloween 1994 episode of Raw, where he ran into the ring and attacked Bob Backlund. They teased a fine or suspension due to what happened the last time he did that, possibly a return to the ring for Macho, but things never came to fruition, as the following week on Raw, November 7th, 1994, Vince cut a promo saying how Randy and the WWF couldn't come to terms on a new contract. He wished him nothing but the best. A really good farewell promo by Vince to Randy, though not the best of farewells to Randy as a whole, as Randy still had a lot to contribute in-ring, and contribute he did when he went to WCW. The WWF legacy of the Macho Man Randy Savage is one of the best ever. Multi-time world champion, huge draw, recognizable name, great talker, great worker, he was the man. Why Vince thought he was too old to contribute is a complete mystery, because had he let Randy still compete in 93 and 94, Randy would have never left the company. So while the end wasn't as great as it could have been, that doesn't take away from a great WWF run. What were your thoughts of Randy Savage during his WWF career? What were some of your favorite Randy Savage matches, moments, and promos during that WWF run? Who are some of the people you wished he could have worked with in 93, 94, and potentially beyond had he stayed with the company? And got any questions about his WWF run? Ask them and I'll answer them via reply. Until next time, peace.
Since 2017, From the Vault has covered various wrestling topics from the past, like pay-per-views, wrestler retrospectives, and much, much more. Make sure to subscribe and click the notification bell. Whatever episodes you're actually listening to, whether current or archived, don't forget to like, comment, and share. And last but not least, like him on Facebook, follow him on Twitter. Be sure to support, because you will get tons of updates on future episodes there. All links are down below, so what are you waiting for? Go enjoy. Bye.
Macho Man Randy Savage.
Get your heart up and he gets the party jumping. He's a Macho Man.